हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू ऑल आर वेल एट होम एंड डूइंग हार्ड वर्क टू अचीव द गोल्स. स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक टू द इकोनॉमिक्स क्लास ऑफ प्लस वन स्टैंडर्ड. वी हैव ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड लेसन नंबर 4, टाइप्स ऑफ इकोनॉमीज. इन दिस वी हैव डिस्कस द टॉपिक डेवलप्ड, डेवलपिंग एंड अंडर डेवलप्ड इकोनॉमीज. टूडे वी विल डिस्कस द टॉपिक डेवलपमेंट एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ इंडिया, अ कंपेरिजन विद पाकिस्तान एंड चाइना. India, Pakistan and China have many similarities in their development strategies. All the three nations started their development efforts at the same time. India and Pakistan got freedom in 1947, while socialism in China came into existence in 1949. These three nations started their planning in similar ways. India commenced its first 5-year plan in 1951, while China has started in 1953 and Pakistan has adopted 1956. Till 2008, Pakistan and India had completed 10 5-year plans, while China had completed till 2006. Development strategies followed by different nations. First one is India. Since 1951, India had completed 6 decades of planning. During plan period, it has achieved success in some directions and failures in others. So, mixed experience with India during plan period. Prior 1991, public sector had been awarded by predominant position in the strategic areas, while private sector was sought to be controlled, restricted and regulated. Several restrictions were imposed on foreign investment in order to promote the domestic production of luxury goods. Industries were protected through high tariff walls. New economic policy was launched by Union Finance Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh in 1991. Government of India has adopted liberalized foreign trade policy. Current trade policy is guided by LPG model. LPG model means liberalization, privatization and globalization. The main objective of the current trade policy are globalization of Indian economy, bigger role of private sector and lesser of the government. Structural reforms have been initiated to lift excess direct control and regulations on industries and ensure a free market oriented economic system. Only 6 industries remain reserved for public sector, that is atomic energy, railway operations like high-speed train projects, railway electrifications, coal and ignite, mineral oil, defense equipment, mining of iron ore, manganese ore, chrome ore, gold, diamond, gypsum, etc. Next one is, under the new economic policy, the resources in public sector used for the development of high technology industries and for social sector like education, health, poverty alleviation programs. Under the liberalization policy, there is abolition of industrial licensing system, and in privatization, government adopt the disinvestment policy, which is called the policy of privatization. Here, disinvestment policy means when the government sell its assets in the hands of the private sector. Next one is Pakistan. There are many similarities in India and Pakistan strategies also, like mixed economy in both the nations, existence of private and public sector, adopted a regulated policy framework in late 1950s till 60s. For country's industrialization, it granted tariff protection to domestic consumer goods industries by direct import control, public investment in agriculture sector and nationalization of capital goods industry. In late 1970s, adoption of the policy of denationalization, it is there in Pakistan. Private sector motivated with this. Pakistan got financial assistance from Western countries that helps in stimulating economic growth. In 1988, reforms were introduced in the economy of the Pakistan. Next one is China. People's Republic of China came into existence in 1949. Under one party rule, all the factors of production are under the government control. A great leap forward program was started in 1958, which aimed at country's industrialization on a large scale. people encouraged to set up industries in their backyards. In several rural areas, village communes or cooperatives were set up under which people cultivated land collectively. In 1978, China introduced reforms in phases. In the initial phase, reforms were introduced in the field of agriculture, foreign trade and investment sector. Commune lands were divided into small plots and allotted to the individual household for cultivation. But ownership rights are not given for these plots to the public. Cultivators can keep all farm income after paying taxes to the government. After this, reforms were introduced in the industrial sector. Private firms and local collectives were allowed to set up manufacturing units, now known as the state-owned enterprises, SOEs. In India, we call it public sector undertakings, that is PSUs, were made to face competition from newly established private sector firms. A dual pricing system was also introduced. Under this system, farmers and industrial units were required to buy and sell fixed quantities of inputs and outputs on the basis of prices fixed by the government, and rest could buy and sell at market prices with the increase in the output. Special economic zones were set up in China. Special economic zones are the areas in which business and trade laws are different from the rest of the country. Special economic zones are located within the national borders of a country, and their aim is to increase the trade balance, increase employment opportunities, increase in the investment and effective administration. In India, there are also special economic zones in Surat, Kandla, Kochi, Chennai, Vishakhapatnam. Next one is development experience. On the basis of rate of growth, GDP, that is gross domestic product, that is national income, of China, that is $8,610, and in India, $3,787, while in Pakistan it is $378. China's GDP, it is the second largest in the world. Slow growth rate of the GDP in all these three nations. Their GDP growth rate remained around 4% per annum. After that, China had been the center of attention of the world during 1980s and 1990, when it was able to achieve and maintain double digit growth rate. Next one is, this was the period when even many developed countries are finding it difficult to achieve a growth rate of 5%. In this, we can see India's growth rate, it was in 1980s till 1990s 5.7, while that of Pakistan it is 6.3 and China it is 10.3. In 1980s till 1990, India was at the bottom, while Pakistan was ahead of India and China was at the number one position. In 2000 till 2010, India's GDP increased from 5.7 to 7.4, while that of Pakistan was decreased to 4.7, and China's GDP remains the same, that is 10.3 only. Now next one is, India and Pakistan recorded growth rate between 5% and 8%, while growth rate was around 10% in China. However, China has succeeded the most in attracting foreign investment, that is special economic zones. Policy of China has been crucial factor in this regard. Special economic zones are offering world-class infrastructure facilities to the foreign investors in China. Next one is, sectoral distribution of output and employment. Sectoral contribution to the GDP in both India and Pakistan, that is a share of agriculture to the GDP, it is in India 17%, in China 10%, and in Pakistan that is 20%, while that of industries contribution, it is 26% in India, 47% in China and 26% in Pakistan. And for the service sector in India, it is 57% contribution to the GDP and 43% in China and 54% in Pakistan. Now next one is, after this one, when distribution of the workforce was there, at that time from the agriculture sector, contribution that is 51%. In China and Pakistan, that is 34% and 45%. Then industrial contribution to the GDP, that is in India 22%, while that of China and Pakistan 29% and 20%. And the service sector contribution 27% in India, while that of China 37% and Pakistan 35%. Industry and service sector have less proportion of workforce but contribute more in terms of output. Service sector is coming up as a major factor in the development of India and Pakistan, whereas it is the manufacturing in China which is coming up very fast. The remarkable growth recorded by the Chinese manufacturing sector was mainly reason is that is a Great Leap Forward campaign launched in 1958. Policy of reforms and opening up launched in 1978, which gave a big push to the export of manufactured goods. So China's growth of largely led by the manufacturing sector, whereas service sector has its mainstay in the growth process of both India and Pakistan. In Pakistan has lagged behind among all these three nations. Next one is demographic feature. China's population was 139.26 crore, while in India that is 135.26 crore, and Pakistan it is 21.22 crore. Growth rate of population is highest in Pakistan, that is 1.68% per annum, while in India it is 1.26% per annum, while in China it is 0.49% per annum. One child norm is the main reason for this lesser growth rate in China, but this one child norm has adverse effect on this China. Because in China, you can see more elder people and less youngsters are there. Urbanization. India's 32% people live in urban areas, while in Pakistan, 37% people live in urban areas, and in China, 52% people live in urban areas. Density of population. China's land area, it is 95,61,000 square kilometer, while in India it is 29,73,190 square kilometer, and in Pakistan it is 7,96,095 square kilometer. So average person of living per square kilometer in China is low, it is 144, and while in India it is 411. Human Development Index. Development of a nation, it is based on the Human Development Index. India ranked 130 and value it is 0.647, while that of China rank it is 85 and its value it is 0.758, and in Pakistan rank it is 152 and its value is 0.560. Human Development Index is the life expectancy, literacy rate and standard of living. 22% population below poverty line in Pakistan, and in India it is 21.9%, while in China it is 15.9%. Sanitation improvements in India and China remains the same, that is 65%, while in Pakistan it is 44%. Maternal mortality rate in India it is 178, while that of China it is 37, and in Pakistan it is 260. Next one is regional and global economic groups. First one is SAARC. The South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation is the regional intergovernmental organization and geopolitical union of states in South Asia. Its member states are India, Maldives, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan and Afghanistan. Founded in 1985, its headquarter it is located at Kathmandu. Goals are promote economical development, and in 2006 SAARC launched the South Asian Free Trade Area, that is SAFTA. Earlier South Asian Preferential Trade Agreement was in operation in 1995. Next one is European Union. European Union is a political and economic union of 27 member states that are located primarily in Europe. Six European countries, France, Belgium, Netherlands, Luxembourg, West Germany and Italy, constituted European Economic Market, that is EEM, on the basis of Rome Treaty. Complete free trade among member nations. At present, European Union is the biggest trading entity. Its headquarters are Brussels. 12 nations of European Union accepted a common currency, Euro. They are Germany, France, Belgium, Netherlands, Luxembourg, Ireland, Italy, Finland, Spain, Portugal, and Greece and Austria. Next one is ASEAN, Association of Southeast Asian Nations, a regional grouping that promotes economic, political, and security cooperation among its 10 members. Brunei, Cambodia, Indonesia, Laos, Malaysia, Myanmar, Philippines, Singapore, Thailand and Vietnam. Its headquarter it is Jakarta. The post of General Secretary of ASEAN is rotated among each member country alphabetically after every 2 years. Next one is G8, Group of 8 Nations. An organization of 7 highly industrialized nations, which includes USA, Canada, Germany, Britain, France, Italy and Japan. After adopting free market policies means privatization it is there and price mechanism policies are there. Russia was also made member of this organization in 1997. At present, it is known as G8, Group of 8 Nations. The member nations of this group account for 49% of the world's trade, that is export, 51% industrial output and 49% of assets in IMF, that is International Monetary Fund, that was situated in 1945. G20, Group of 20 Nations, Group of 20 International Forum of the governments and the central bank governors from 19 countries and European Union. Objective is to promote informal dialogue and cooperation among important nations within the framework of Bretton Woods system to maintain financial stability. Here Bretton Woods system means a system of payments based on dollar, which defined all currencies in relation to dollars itself convertible into gold and above all as good as gold for trade. US currency now effectively the world currency and the standard to which every other currency was pegged. Pegged means fixed. Broader participation of both from industrialized countries and emerging markets. Member nations are Argentina, Australia, Canada, Brazil, France, China, Germany, India, Italy, Japan, Indonesia, Russia, Mexico, Saudi Arabia, South Korea, Africa, Turkey, UK, USA and the chairman country of European Union. Chairman country of European Union right now it's Finland. Multilateral trade liberalization within the WTO framework is the main objective. So students, hope you all have understood the topic. Now it's time to note down the homework. क्वेश्चन नंबर वन इज राइट अ नोट ऑन सात यूरोपियन यूनियन ASEAN G8 G20. Write a note on development experience of India, China and Pakistan. And students, please go through the links on the YouTube also for more clarity. Thank you for listening.